Hey, how's it going, guys? It's Nate here. And the story of Skyrim is one of dragons, magic, prophecies, and more gods than you could count on your fingers. Indeed, the Elder Scrolls universe is one that plays by a very different set of rules than what we're all probably used to. And in an environment so dominated by fantasy and strange forces, Bethesda had the opportunity to absolutely fill it with what at times seems like a bottomless collection of mysteries and strange happenings they intentionally left unexplained, all in an effort to keep Skyrim's players on their toes. So today, we'll be continuing with our 12th installment in a series that's become a staple of this channel. Throw another log on the fire, sit back, and relax as we take a look at five more spooky mysteries in The Elder Scrolls V Skyrim. Starting off, I'd like to begin today by discussing the curious case of the wooden mask. So, one of the cooler little secrets Bethesda hid in Skyrim was the unique dragon priest mask, Conaric. Essentially, after the player has slain every single named dragon priest in the game and taken their masks, you can head on over to the Labyrinthian, a massive ancient Nord ruin that was once the largest city in Skyrim back when the dragons and their priests still ruled over man, but now is just a pile of rubble. If we enter a small sanctuary at the Labyrinthian's outdoor center, inside will be a strange wooden mask lying on the ground before a skeleton in front of some busts. Should the player take that mask and equip it, you'll be teleported, seemingly back in time, to before when this building was ruined. And then, we can place each of the Dragon Priest masks in our inventory on those busts. Once done, a hidden mechanism will be triggered, and you'll be able to take a new, unique Dragon Priest mask, called Conaric for yourself, before being teleported back to the present day. We've already touched upon the many mysteries surrounding the Conaric mask, like who it belonged to and why it was so special. But perhaps an even more interesting thought to explore is what was going on with the wooden mask that sends us back in time in the first place. I mean, this is one of the very few instances in the entire Elder Scrolls franchise where we experience actual, genuine time travel ourselves, and are even able to bring an object forward back with us. How can we ignore that? Well, if we go back to right about where we find the wooden mask in the first place, right next to it and the skeleton is a note that provides some insight on the mask's origin. The note is a seemingly couple-year-old diary entry from a mercenary who claims he was hired to protect some Breton scholar and his mask on their journey to the sanctuary from High Rock. The mercenary alleges that the scholar was a bit, well, annoying, and was really overprotective of his mask. When they finally arrived here, the Breton told him to watch as he put it on and disappeared before the mercenary's eyes. The scholar continued to go back and forth, reappearing and disappearing, sometimes for hours at a time, claiming he was trying to do something while he was gone. The mercenary concludes his writing by saying that he's getting really frustrated, and the next time his client appears, he's going to stab him. And sure enough, the skeleton at this location has an orcish dagger right through his ribcage, implying that this was no bluff. So, what does this letter tell us? For one, and maybe most significantly, it implies that the wooden mask isn't even from around here, seeing as it evidently was brought to this location by a Breton from somewhere else. So, where did it come from? Additionally, it seems like the mask must only allow for you to go back in time if you're standing in this very building, considering the client didn't really start using it until he got here. So, would this be the only area it has any power? Akatosh, the father of all dragons, is also the god of time. So, a dragon priest mask that's able to manipulate time a bit, while strange, isn't entirely out of the realm of possibility. One idea is that this isn't even the only wooden mask in existence. There could in fact be many more scattered across Tamriel. This is merely one that we found. Others have proposed that perhaps this was the mask donned by Valok the Jailer, a dragon priest in Solstheim who, notably, is the only named priest without a mask. There's just so many questions here and even fewer answers. But hey, at least a mask is more convenient than a DeLorean. Next on our list, we have the many mysteries surrounding the Elder Gleam Tree. But before we can fully explore them, a reasonable bit of context is needed. So, within the city of Whiterun, right in the center of the settlement's Wind District, an ancient tree known as the Gildergleam can be found. It's of great religious significance to much of the population, and apparently, people from across Tamriel make great pilgrimages to see it. However, recently the tree's hit something of a rough patch. Its flowers have begun whittling, the color of its bark has faded. The tree is sick, and many fear it's only gonna get worse. Enter Danica Pearspring, a local priestess of Kinnereth who has a plan to save it. You see, the Gildergleam, while pretty old, believe it or not, has a still active parent tree that it came from as a sapling, the Eldergleam. The Eldergleam, it is said, is the oldest living thing in all of Skyrim, and Danica even suggests that it could be the oldest being in all of Tamriel. The priestess believes that if we can get some of the Eldergleam sap and give it to its child, I use air quotations there, the Gildergleam, that should save Whiterun's favorite tree. This is the basis of the quest, The Blessings of Nature. Now, because the Eldergleam is just so old, older than metal apparently, we can't just walk up to it and cut it open with any axe to get to its sap. But fear not, for Danica claims to know of a blade that should be able to do the trick. It's called Nettlebane, and she alleges it's currently in the possession of a small coven of hagravens who use it to sacrifice Spriggans. We will have to journey to Orphan's Rock to defeat the Hagravens, take Nettlebane from them, and report back to Danica, who will then send us off to get the sap from the Eldergleam at its sanctuary. When we arrive before the tree, we'll find a cave it's in currently hosting a massive gathering of pilgrims, who will beg the Dragonborn not to cut into it, claiming that it's wrong to harm something of such beauty. And the Dovahkiin will ultimately have to choose between just cutting the tree open and bringing some sap back to Danica, or listening to these pilgrims' concerns, and not doing that. Instead, they'll be able to pray to the tree for a new sapling and give that to us. A sapling won't save the Gildergleam like sap would, but if we give it to Danica, she can simply plant a new, equally neat tree in its place. Whatever option you do end up choosing will largely only affect Danica's dialogue with the player when you meet up with her for the final time, and either will do just fine, and complete the quest all the same. So, now for the big questions. What is the Eldergleam? How did it get here, and what else is it capable of? We know that if pilgrims pray to it, asking for saplings, the tree will deliver. So clearly it must have some level of sentience, or of self-awareness, or listening skills that your normal blade of grass or shrub lacks. Heck, during the Blessings of Nature quest, as we make our way up to the Eldergleam, we'll have to hack at its roots, which seem to retreat in pain when we hit them with Nettlebane, in order to clear a path. So there's some real mental capabilities here that shouldn't be. Additionally, why is it only that Nettlebane can cut the thing? I mean, okay, I get that the tree's older than metal or whatever, but what's the big deal about this blade in particular? Why were Hagravens using it first, and what was the point of them sacrificing Spriggans with it? We'll likely not have an answer to any of these inquiries anytime soon. Whatever's up with this tree, only the tree itself seems to know. Alright, so the last two mysteries we've assessed are some fairly game-changing ones, right? We're dealing with time travel and ancient trees older than civilization itself. So, coming in at number 3, I'd like us to narrow our focus a bit to an enigma that is still very fascinating, but a little less world-shattering. Within the Walls of Solitude, in a small crevice just behind Angeline's Aromatics, the local potion shop, a very strange scene can be found. Here, just in front of a sewage drain, lies a disgusting, almost decomposed body in imperial armor, referred to as desecrated corpse, next to a dead skeever of all things. What do we have here? When I initially stumbled upon this years ago, I assumed it was a part of some quest or something, but nope, none of the game's missions so much as acknowledge what we're looking at. And there's not even much of an implication regarding how this fellow came to die. The body is in full, heavy imperial armor, So not only was this character well-equipped, they were likely well-trained too, which would make it kind of odd if they were murdered to death by a simple skeever, not to mention how embarrassing that would be. Strangely, there is one other place in Skyrim we can find similar desecrated corpses, at Meridia's temple in Kilgreave. During the quest, The Break of Dawn, the Daedric Goddess of Light sends us to go clear the temple out of an evil necromancer named Malkaron, who's been digging up the bodies of fallen Imperial and Stormcloak soldiers, and enslaving their spirits, turning them into evil, corrupted shades to do his bidding. It's implied that part of the process Malkaron uses to subjugate the souls of these fallen warriors is what caused their remains to become blackened and so desecrated. Could it be that the lifeless Imperial behind Angeline's aromatics suffered a similar fate? Or maybe Bethesda just wanted to make it look like a decomposing body. However this poor fellow met his end, be it at the hands of a necromancer, the jaws of a skeever, or maybe even the blade of a secret killer, it matters not. Just make sure to watch your back the next time you're in Skyrim's capital city. For fourth spot, after the player has completed a side quest for a Daedric god, said deity will typically reward the player with a unique, custom item for your service. Sanguine, Lord of Debauchery, will give you a staff shaped like a rose that he claims to have picked from Oblivion. Molag Bal will offer a powerful, cursed mace that he tricked some blacksmith to forge thousands of years ago. Sheogorath will give you a staff that he you get the point. All of the Daedric gods give you these really special objects that have some of their personality built in. Well, all except two. Malakath, Daedric god of oaths and curses, gives the player Volundrung upon completing his mission, the Cursed Tribe. Now, the thing about Volundrung is that its origins aren't Daedric at all. As we learned through a number of books and the events of previous Elder Scrolls games, Volundrung was a hammer originally forged by a Dwemer clan called the Rauken. Legend has it that thousands of years ago, before the dwarves went extinct, the Rauken decided to leave their homeland in Morrowind in search of new regions to settle. Their king decided to throw his personal warhammer, Volundrung, really high in the air, and wherever it landed, his people would move to. The hammer eventually found itself touching down in modern-day Hammerfell. And yes, that's why it's called Hammerfell. After this, all record of Volundrung is lost. The dwarves would go on to just disappear one day, and no one really knows what they did with their hammer. So how the heck did Malakath, a Daedric prince, end up with it? Likewise, Periite, Daedric Lord of Diseases and Pestilence, will give the player a special dwarven shield, called Spellbreaker, for completing his quest and becoming his champion. Spellbreaker, too, actually also belonged to that same Rauken clan, as we learn in the book Tamrielic Lore. So the question is, how did Periite and Malakath get their grubby little supernatural hands on these dwarven items that they seemingly had nothing to do with? The gods themselves don't offer any explanation at all. They just say, "Here, take my artifacts," without even pointing out that they're dwarven. And it's not just in Skyrim. In previous Elder Scrolls games, Volundrung is consistently rewarded to the player by Malakath, with zero context provided. The same is true with Spellbreaker and Periite. So Bethesda has created a clear, strong, and intentional association between these gods and those dwarven materials. But why? A seemingly apparent possibility is that perhaps the Rauken dwarves who made both the hammer and shield had worked out some sort of deal with Periite and Malakath beforehand. Maybe Malakath helped the tribe forge the hammer, and Periite helped them out with the shield. Or, even more troublesome and fun to speculate, is that maybe these Daedric gods played a part in the demise of the dwarves to begin with. Maybe the Daedra had something to do with their disappearance. Or maybe Malakath and Periite just happened to stumble upon these artifacts on a morning stroll or something. Regardless of what the truth is here, considering Volundrung and Spellbreaker have appeared in so many Elder Scrolls games prior to Skyrim, we can almost certainly expect them to return in The Elder Scrolls 6. Hopefully that game will hold some answers when it releases in the next couple of decades or whatever. And finally, last on our list, we're heading on out back to the Soul Cairn, a plane of oblivion that's become an absolute favorite of this channel. Harboring the souls of those who have been soul-trapped, it's an especially gloomy place, and the region maintains a very dark, intimidating, gothic style of architecture. At the center of the region we get to explore is a massive castle currently housing Valerica, a vampire who we'll have to save in the Dawnguard DLC questline, though her story is one for another day. Just north of this castle is a small fortress, and at the center of it will be a somewhat submerged word wall of all things. Wait, what's this doing here? Word walls are of course a staple of Skyrim. In gameplay, we can walk up to one to learn a various word of power from one of the game's many dragon shouts. Legend has it that they were built thousands of years ago, way back when dragons were still roaming the skies. They were used for a multitude of purposes. Sometimes they would commemorate great battles, other times they would be used sort of like tombstones to honor fallen men. But they were all built in Skyrim. So what's one of those doing all the way here in this dimension of oblivion? This word wall is pretty much unusable. It has no dragon shouts attached to it, nor is there even any writing on it as there are with most word walls. It's just blank and sort of inactive. We know from looking around the Soul Cairn that it does seem possible objects from the mortal realms can somehow find their way here. Various skeletons and weapons that obviously came from Nirn lie all throughout the area, so it's possible, though structures seem like a bit of a stretch. Did the ideal masters, the rulers of the Cairn, somehow order this to be constructed or make a deal to acquire one? What did this word wall originally say if it did come from Nirn? Did it have some cool word of power attached? To say that we're absolutely clueless would be an understatement. We know nothing about this. But hey, at least it was only a word wall that was teleported to here and not like an entire city or something, as far as we know. Anyway, with that we are going to wrap up our 12th episode of Spooky Skyrim Mysteries. Thanks for stopping in, everybody. What are your own theories behind some of the curious conundrums we've explored today? What unexplained phenomenons do you think deserve additional attention next? Leave a comment down below. As always, like ratings are very much appreciated. A huge shout out to channel members and patrons, and hope to catch you all in my next video. Peace out, everyone.